So there we go. It's hard to believe it's our last presentation here in our main forum track one. Digital transformation, of course, also affects the financial sector. Please welcome the head of IT at Donner & Reuschel, Mr. Andreas Weinberger. Welcome.
Thank you. I have a very uninteresting topic for you. The topic of regulation in an environment or enterprise architecture in a regulated environment. And this picture shows really, really clear what's happening here. We have an environment with a huge amount of rules. And these rules are necessary because there is a lot of danger in this environment. You see the power lines, you see the escalators, you see the heavy trains. In such an environment, people are moving around and they have to be secure. And on the other hand, the architecture has the role to make it beautiful, nice, important to enjoy such an environment. And I want to show you some things that I learned out of my practice. But first of all, I have to tell you, rules suck. And this is a clear statement from my side, and I guess a lot of you have the same problems. As you see here, clearly defined rules, someone doesn't adhere to the rules. And we have a wonderful example. I didn't know this when I started this presentation, that I would be standing here, and we have a wonderful example why rules suck. You know, this is our famous Bundesadler. To be exactly, it's Bundesadler number 3. And he's not very lean, you see. So in Germany, we call it the fette Henne. It was not easy or impossible to make it more lean, since some rules adhere. The designer that designed this has the rule to the design, the right to the design, but they is not able to do any change with this symbol. And since rules suck, I have to make some confessions, since I kind of took my freedoms with a lot of rules by building this presentation. I will not read every one of here, and I guess it's roughly half of the rules I broke. So the rules on the right side show you some things, and on the left side I always told you what I have done against the rules. And what's the important part? Most people don't know all the rules that adhere to a situation. So for example, we have a guideline in our company how the corporate identity has to be managed. I clearly didn't adhere to this. Linux is now Lean IX. That's also a rule. We have rules to do picture attribution and lots of other things where you have to adhere to, from grammar, from technical rules, and you often don't have the chance to know all of the rules. And this is an important point in a business environment, since the company has to adhere to our rules, and nobody knows all the rules. So, what were you doing about this? First of all, here I changed one of the rules. I took now the correct color for the title, but it helps not very much. Where do regulations adhere? We have regulated industries. And this was very interesting to see, since I'm in banking in the financial area, and we know that we are one of the units that are heavily regulated. And I looked this up. On the right side, you see a statistics of the most regulated industries. And when you take a look at the list, there are lots of industries that are regulated now. And health, food, energy, mobility, for example, finance. And information technology in itself is also regulated. And especially since GDPR, nearly everyone and everything knows that there is a heavy regulation depending on data and information for personal information. So to sum it up, nearly everyone is involved more or less in regulations. So what things, what areas are regulated? We have regulated areas, IT and the IT governance. We have compliance, risk management, IT management, general management, information security, data protection, cybersecurity. Everywhere in these areas, we have regulations. These are regulated areas. And then now, we'll show you my viewpoint. And for this viewpoint, it's important to know where I work. I work at a company called Donner & Reuschel. And this company was 60 years old when the Valiant guys opened up their shop. This is a bank that's 220 years old. It's a small bank, and it's part of an insurance group. So we have a bank in an insurance group with a legacy of 220 years. This bank resides in Europe and in two different countries, in Germany and Luxembourg. And in Germany, we have the funny situation, we are in Hamburg and in Bavaria. So we have also some rules that are different between the Hamburg office and the Munich office. We are doing business worldwide, so again, more rules. And we're doing this in a broad range of financial services, so even more rules. And the internal IT is a service provider for integration. We are integrating lots of technical systems, and we have lots of outsourced ITs, so a lot of steering of our service providers is necessary. I can tell you, this work situation is kind of a regulation nightmare. And my personal role has two sides. On the one hand, I'm head of IT. I'm responsible for the internal IT department and for provider management for IT providers. And I'm head of the IT governance committee, and this is the internal IT governance unit, kind of a CIO office. So I always have the situation, at least, to have two viewpoints on the same topics. In reality, sometimes there are four, five, or six viewpoints that I have. So my look at regulations. That's a typical situation in Germany, especially here in Hamburg, you see a lot of single rules that you have to adhere to. And when I thought about regulation, I thought, okay, let's not use the bank regulations, that's not helpful for you, let's use regulations that are important for all of you. And that's first, the regulation GDPR. And with GDPR, you could hear a lot about GDPR in the other sessions. It's very easy to see, okay, it's about data and processors. So one important way is to go with the processing. And I made this picture, how we dealt partly with GDPR in Linux. It is a two-sided approach. On the one hand, you are coming from the processes, and the processes have an impact on the business capabilities and the process fact sheets, of course. And the other approach is the application-driven approach, directly looking into what does the application do. And I can tell you, the application-driven support is much faster as the process-driven driven approach, since you have more oversight and much fewer items. What you can do, you can take information out of the process and business capabilities, use this information to set it into the data objects and IT components, and from there you can mark the applications and the IT components or enrich these fact sheets with additional information. I always talk about contaminated systems. As soon as personal data flows through an interface, through an application, through an IT component, it kind of gets contaminated and is therefore important in GDPR regards. And what for me was very interesting, since our GDPR project worked the GDPR topics, for me is very interesting what impact GDPR has on my portfolio on applications and IT components. Where do I have to do something to enhance the systems, to enhance security, for example, to enhance, to use more encryption, and to get this information also into Linux to be able to follow up to manage this change. And in regard of processes, if you don't have any processes, that's often the case with smaller companies and lower, not as much regulated companies, please be aware, you always can use generic frameworks to kind of find your way through the complete system. This is one example where a process classification framework exists, the APQC's process classification framework, and this is a cross-industry process framework where you can find inspiration how to set up your processes. Sometimes very helpful to use these things, especially if you are discussing different processes and you take a framework to compare your own thinking to a more broader standard. In the banking area, we have another very interesting process framework. It's a BIAN framework that tries to give us a generic framework for banking processes. And what we did, we took the BIAN framework to find the business capabilities. Our company didn't use business capabilities, and when we introduced Linux, we immediately decided to try to find a standard where we could use to find the business capabilities, and we took the BIAN framework up for that. And to give you a small hint, we ingested the BIAN framework. This is an open framework. You can register on the BIAN website and you can get the information. We ingested the complete BIAN framework into Linux, and we have the complete business capabilities there imported. It's roughly, it's exactly 341 fact sheets, so you don't have to do the typing. You can import a generic framework out of this. And when you take a look at this, with the visualizer, this is an exact copy of the BIAN framework as it's in their system. They have an online framework where you can see this completely ingested into Linux. And there you can see exactly, or you can use it to map your own frameworks by using it as an idealistic model where you can fit to your own needs. So this, in the regard of regulation in the direction of GDPR, make sure that you get information out of the processes and into your system to be able, from the IT side, to react to the changes or to even plan these changes. We were on the upside on one thing. We had to rebuild a lot of our integration structure, and this allows us to address topics out of the GDPR by setting the design principles for the new project and follow up by Linux. We defined, okay, we will solve these issues by doing these projects and follow up and manage this change. Another important regulation, a banking-specific regulation, is the BAIT. This is coming from the Federal Financial Supervisory Authority, the BaFin in Germany. And this adheres to all financial units, and it is an additional framework that is for insurances. And the interesting thing is, these are the modules that this regulation consists of, and the interesting thing is, it's not only bank-specific, since it fits very well into COBIT. COBIT is a management framework for management of enterprise IT that is not specific to banks, but it's usable for all of information management or information technology. And if you look at this special regulation, it kind of shows a lot what's already in COVID. So it's very interesting. Since this shows you clearly, then you can use COVID to react to a lot of regulation, or even to prepare for a lot of regulation. I give you a quick picture into COVID. These are 39 areas where COVID defines what you have to organize to do to govern and manage enterprise IT. You don't have to read all of these. I show you two examples. One example is manage your enterprise architecture. The other example is manage knowledge. The other areas, of course, contain all the topics that are important to do IT. But these two areas are very interesting, since Lean IX is optimally designed to deal with these two topics. COVID also knows the so-called enterprise enablers. And these are things like principles, policies, frameworks that you use for governance, processes, again, processes within IT, organizational structures, the culture, the ethics and the behavior, information itself as a resource, service infrastructure and applications, and people's skills and competencies. And if you took a look at Lean IX, you immediately see, okay, at least five of these areas you can manage with Lean IX. So it's a very, very good tool where you can, if you are using COVID, you can use it a lot to do with COVID. And this is a very important point, since I'm not an enterprise architect. I have these other roles, and even there, this originally enterprise architecture tool helps me a lot in doing my work and the work of the people that are dealing with these issues. To enhance this a little bit, we ingested all of the COVID processes, and there are a lot of them. It's 211 one, also in a demo space. So you have an original model for COVID processes within Linux available. So now I wanted to explain to you a little bit a way of working, how I do it. The first learning with Linux, or working with Linux, for me was very interesting. As I told you, a bank of 220 years, what we really good in the IT is producing lists, reports and lists. And we have lists of the relevant core applications, and this list I'll find in our really report. We have a list of applications that are topic of a license management review. We have list of all applications that are in the scope of a cloud project. Lists, 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 and lists. In a Linux world, we have the opportunity, if I need a fixed list, I have to be sure that this list doesn't change as a report does. I simply set up a fact sheet, a project fact sheet, and put in this list, for example, applications. And one thing I learned, all our lists in the old world had the information topic A, B, or application A, B, and C are member of this list. In the Linux world, that is very interesting. I have a list with application A, B, and C, but each of the applications has the additional information, oh, I'm a member of this list. This is the first very important point. Each item that I add in a fact sheet has the information I belong to this as a fact sheet. And even more, each of these connections can contain additional information, and this information you see on both sides. So this is a very, very important point in dealing and using this system. And the second thing, if I need to have some reports with additional information, I can purely use it as a filter. So using a fact sheet to generate a list of applications, a list of applications plus IT components, easily doable, and then this result comes out. So for example here, I had exactly the thing, the three lists that I described, They all contained our core banking system. And on the other side, you see, if I look in the fact sheet of the core banking system, I see it belongs to these three lists, and I know the interconnectedness. That was a first very important point of working with Linux from my perspective. And the second important point is the information flow. This picture shows you not that users and IT department should not talk to one another, but the information flow in regard of information into the system is very important. Users can get information and put information into the system. The IT department can do the same, and the governance stakeholders can also do the same. And the red ones, I can give the audit and regulators read access to our system. He needs information. And the feedback from the auditors goes over the stakeholders into the system again. So this enables us to get into a learning curve in a continual improvement process to learn out of failures, to know out of findings, and get this information back into Linux, all with information flow that has not to go through the departments. And this is very, very important. Also for such things, if a user has a question and he often has the problem of finding the guy that could answer this question, is very helpful. And the governance stakeholders, for example, they can learn out of these questions. If a governance stakeholder finds out that a business department is asking a strange question, perhaps they are planning, they want to get rid of an application and they don't really announce this, this could also be a very important information. And I would now jump directly into some working examples. What I did in preparation for this for this talk, I took all the screenshots that I made out of Linux in the last 2 years. And I always asked myself, what was the issue there? What did we try to accomplish? And I would try to explain to you what I did there. Those are working examples. The first one, it's a very simple one. It's a rule-based application portfolio management. So we take the technical value, and the technical guys make a rule-based assumption how they like this application with a very simple rule set. We told them, okay, no patch management, old hardware, no support anymore, one star. The application will be not available any longer within the next 2 years, two stars. So they made a technical assessment, and the business guys made a business criticality assessment. And then we did a very simple thing. We told them, we told our IT governance committee, okay, we make a rule-based assessment, we don't want to have this quadrant. Everything in this quadrant is bad, we want to do something against it. Don't bother about the details, we want to get rid of this quadrant. And since it's very difficult to change the business continuity, we simply do the following thing. We set up projects. We define projects how to deal with this situation. And for every system where we don't find an answer how to solve this problem, that we go back to the governance board and decide how to deal with this application. Mostly it's replacing an application through a more modern one or switching it off completely. Rule-based application portfolio management, purely based on data and completely disentangled from discussions like a technical guy, okay, I can live with this application by doing this and that. No. Simple rule-based and rule-based assessment. He should tell us, I don't like this application from a technical standpoint, and the decision is taken elsewhere. Another example, direct screenshot out of my box was this one. I found an application where a lot of text was in the description area, and I simply took a screenshot and marked, here is information that should belong into this field, and here is information that is kind of strange. And then I asked some questions. For example, here, it was an application where you clearly saw there must be some users, but there was no marker for user management. It was clearly visible that it's using Excel, but the link to Excel was missing. It was clearly visible that it is taking information out of a Reuters system. This link was missing. There was no marker where the license management happens, and there was even another software name in it that we didn't know about. The most important part in this regard, I did not talk to them and say, told them, okay, you have to fill out all the fields. I just told them, okay, give me the information, and by asking the questions back, we fulfill more and more information. And this is the kind of conversation. Some of the other guys already talked about it. The conversation aspect is very, very important. Look up what you see, ask your questions, and enhance the information. And first of all, getting information and then putting it in the right fields. A second information what was also very interesting, this is a roadmap view that was I used to filter to a certain point of time. I saw in the tag group, oh, there is a switchover point. A switchover point where lots of applications should be replaced by others. And I filtered the list according to this, and I clearly saw, okay, these timeframes cannot be correct, since in this month, a lot of technical changes happening, so there must something be happening in these fact sheets. Okay, so it immediately gave me roughly 15 questions. What's happening there? Why is the life cycle not according to the project? And this cross-checking of life cycle values is a very important point, since there we found a lot of inconsistencies. Another interesting point was finding missing user management. We have a special tag, and with this tag, we mark all applications that are kind of access-only. Our users access it by the internet, and we from the IT department, we have to do nearly nothing or very, very few services to make this possible. But using an application in the internet often needs a rights management, a user management. And this was missing in this case. And with this filter, we immediately saw, okay, something accesses something in the internet, there is no user management for it, so there must be a difference. We must clearly find out who is responsible for the user management of this application. Always cross-checking. Another cross-check was mode of operations. We asked the application guys, how do you see your applications? Are these applications that are provided from the internal IT? Or are they outsourced? Or is there kind of a mixed mode? Mixed mode, for example, we distribute a FAT client and the provider provides the back application. And we asked these questions to the application owners from the left side in the application. And in the same time, we asked the technical guys, on the other hand, okay, what kind of interfaces are there? And the system owners on the IT components, what are you doing? Delivering VPN networks, certificates, FAT clients and such things. And you immediately saw that these two pictures didn't fit. The application owners often thought, okay, IT is doing nothing there, and IT told me clearly we're doing a lot of things. And this classification generated a lot more insight on both sides, how different the pictures were, and how much misunderstanding in all the application frameworks was. Another thing that we are doing are kind of little projects or little tasks, and documenting this within Linux. In this example, under the IT governance lead, we told him, okay, in regard of cybersecurity, we have to do one thing, we have to find out all of our websites. And this was a task, it's a simple project fact sheet, set up a application fact sheet for all of our websites and link it to this task. That was a very interesting point, since we could see, okay, now they found more websites, and in analyzing the websites, we found out more steps to do. For example, clearing up the domain registrations. And this was a very interesting check, so you could give a task to the different people, generate the income, and and do the follow-up for additional information. The next thing was cross-referencing information. We had the information in this regard that we have two applications where we will have a problem of using a modern browser like Microsoft Edge. And we have set up a fact sheet where we are dealing with IT strategy, and we have child fact sheets for every single detail. For example, browser strategy. And in a browser strategy, it's very helpful to know what applications we do have that have a problem with certain browsers. And this information is there. The red fields clearly show Microsoft Edge not available with these applications. And by linking this application that needs a browser to the browser strategy fact sheet and adding this information, you see in the browser fact sheet easily what constraints are there. And so you have the information on both sides. Just for information, I have a lot of information in the text boxes below of the presentation. So if it's too deep, you always find more information there. Then another thing what we did, finding strange combinations. So we have a tag group that's called EDV. This is end user computing. Also a thing in banks that we don't like very much, but it's always there. And we have another tag that means developed by a foreign company. And these two filters don't fit together. And if you put it together, you find some results. Also very interesting, immediately ask the questions, okay, are these tags correct? And if they are correct, what strange combination do we hear? If another company produces this software, who is responsible for developing this software in this way? And this cross-checking you can do with all kinds of information, and a kid can tell you, try the stupidest things, since you will always find something strange in it. Just try it out. Think about what combination may not be the correct one, and just take a look at your systems, so you will find much, much, much more interesting things that are strange. And one important point in the complete regulation environment is always with these different roles that are running around. You always have the problem that there may be a regulation that you don't know of, and that needs an information that that a guy has that you also don't know of, and you have to have the combination. And this was an example. We had a regulatory tags for all kind of regulation. So we always asked this application what rules, what regulations we do have to follow for this application. And we didn't know what in our systems, in our financial systems, what systems were ledgers. And in doing a cloud project, we found out that in Germany, there is a rule when you are moving a system that's containing a ledger outside of Germany, you have to get permission of the authorities beforehand. This was an interesting point. We didn't have this information. So we started gathering this information, and we were already of the opinion, okay, we should have most regulations in the system. No, we didn't. So we added this additional information and immediately saw, okay, we have roughly 7 ledgers, and from the 7 ledgers, one was not in the system and especially marked. So we get the formal authorization, and we are now able to move it. And this was again one example. Nobody on the technical side had any idea that this information would be necessary in the complete system. So for me, it's very important from a governance point to talk to lots of people in stakeholders in governance to get all this information together that the different heads have without knowing of if this information is later needed or not, but you have it available. This is very interesting. And what we did in the starting phase, I gathered all the stakeholders for governance, so risk management, for example, the security guys, lots of different people in one room, and we asked them all, okay, what information about our IT environment do you need? And there was always the thing, and even with this style, we didn't know that this single information, being a ledger or not, was important. And we found lots and lots and lots of such things. For example, inconsistencies in filtered lists. You filter a list on not GDPR relevant, where we had marked all the systems, and connected to the data object customer. Since a customer, a person, has personal information, so it must be GDPR relevant. Of course, what we did find, oh, there are different kind of customers. Yeah? Since if a customer is a company in itself, GDPR does not apply. So this was correct. But then in the same list, we found other examples where someone had forgotten or set the information wrong. The timelines. Check the timelines if these are fitting to the projects and to changes. One approach, this is the third one, was a very interesting one. We tried to move a group of systems. A migration. And the technical guys always told us, no, we cannot move a cluster of things, we have to move the complete thing, it's much too complicated, much too interconnected. And even there, we did some checks, and we clearly found out by filtering the lists to all kind of combinations that there were no systems findable that were not interconnected. But what we did find, we found some clusters where not so much interconnections were there, and eventually found a way to move parts of the complete systems. And one important point was watching for keywords. Always look in the technical descriptions, what you find. There's always some things in it where you see keywords and you can ask questions. And this is also always very, very helpful to get much more information and ask the right questions. Lessons learned in the last 1.5 years. To find and involve all stakeholders that may have a necessity to get information about our IT environment. Be aware that these people always have hugely different perspectives and their understanding, and not even the language is the same one. Be aware that these people have a different maturity level in these regards. So this also makes it sometimes difficult to talk about the things and immediately ask questions. Since if something is unclear, the discussion, the asking questions is always helpful. Check the data. That was a very important point, since we ingested a lot of information from a system that was there before, and it was hugely inconsistent data. Check the timelines. And one very important point, cross-check with available documentation and or output. Especially as a regulated company, you always have a lot of output, formal output, and just take this formal output, even the older one, and check it against your data in Linux, and you will immediately find interesting things, things that are missing, things that you oversaw. Validate your data modeling. Just ask yourself the questions, do I see that what I wanted in the reports? And one important part, don't overthink, learn by doing, try things. Go into Linux and try things. The learning curve is much faster as only thinking about it and then starting it. So to give you some help in dealing with this, I give you some tools, a toolbox. What I did, I gathered the toolbox for IT governance and management. We just thought about what tools do we need or do we use? A process management system, an EAM system, an information security management system, or something light, A ticket system, a workflow system, user management systems, and contract management. And we took this approach, the view on the toolbox, and we documented it. What we did there, for example, the EasySMS Lite, we immediately set up in Linux itself. It's a very, very simple situation. We have two types of fact sheets. We measure the need for security, and on the other side, the level of security that is provided, and match it to one another. This is a very, very simple, very fast system that was built before the real ASMS system was set up to get a very, very fast to a certain point of information. It could be very, very helpful if you have a problem there to start such a discussion. The setting up of the information is a thing of some days in regard of month for the fully developed system. And we modeled our own toolbox for governance tools with a complete data flow in between, between the different systems. As you see, LinaX in the center, ingesting lots of information from the other systems and possibility to use it in several regards. What I would give you as an overview, when you look at Linux, you see that there in the tech stack, not in the tech stack, in the stack of fact sheets, you have several possibilities. And if you see on the right, in regard of GDPR, what you can do, you can find and mark relevant capabilities and processes in the fact sheets. You can look up responsibility and information owners in the user groups. You can measure impact in the project fact sheets. You can see in the application fact sheets where the processing and the interaction with data takes place. In the interface, you see the pathways data take. In the data objects itself, very helpful, you can tag information on a very detailed level and filter for information. So if the data sheet is the data object is connected to the applications, you can clearly find all applications with a certain amount of data is going through. In the IT components, you have this contaminated area, all GDPR relevant information that is moving through IT components has a certain result, so you have to make sure that these IT components are safe. You have the providers, these are often processors of data. And in the technical stack, you can also tag and filter everything that may be relevant for GDPR. So in the regard of GDPR, you can enrich a lot of information. In the COBIT column, I showed you what COBIT areas and what COBIT enablers you can connect within the LinaX fact sheet stack. There you can easily see enabler like processes in the process fact sheets, services in the application fact sheets, information in the data object fact sheets, and different processes and responsibilities you can easily fit into these fact sheets. So don't only think about the process framework of your company, think of the process framework of IT itself within Linux. It's always eat your own dog food, though you can much more easily manage this. And in the material column, I showed you LinaX often publishes these cool posters where a lot of information is in it, and they have made a poster for technical stack, they have made a poster for business capabilities, and in the red lines, I showed you what information we have available in the demo space. Already there, since these are standard frameworks, and we ingested it in a demo space, ready for use and for tryout. It's very interesting to see or use these generic processes to match your own, for example, toolbox against this. And the other two frameworks I had there was the Beon framework and Technopedia. This is always information available for the different fact sheets from outside, so you don't have to fill all this information on yourself. To sum it up, we had roughly we are now in our second years or a year of using LinaX, and from my different roles, I am using it more and more in interaction with, for example, auditors, and in the interaction with the IT governance committee, from a governance perspective and from a management perspective. And this was the interesting thing for me, since this is not the normal view of the enterprise architect. These are guys, they also do their things, modeling and in it, but I got a huge value out of this system in my different roles. And I know, since we are the smallest company here, from the speaker's side, that in the big companies, you always have more separated roles, but perhaps it's helpful for you to see how these different disciplines can interact. This was my ride through LinaX. I'm open for questions.